helps to bring to fruition and completion the political and intellectual movement that we know as the Enlightenment. He brings this to its highest phase of perfection in many ways. And at the same time, he was a severe critic of the Enlightenment. He was a close friend and associate of men like Diderot, who was the general editor of the Encyclopedia, the great French contribution to the age of the Enlightenment. And yet he excoriated the progress of the arts and the sciences and worried about their effect on the moral life of communities. He was a writer who wore different hats. He defended what he called the savage, sauvage, against the civilized man. He took the side of the poor and the dispossessed against the elites. And he adopted the posture of the loyal son and citizen of Geneva against the sophisticated Parisian intellectuals of his time. So who was Rousseau and what did he stand for? That's what I want us to begin to try to find out a little about today. Okay? Is all right with you? That works? Okay. The second discourse, the discourse on inequality, is in the eyes of many readers Rousseau's greatest work. I'm not sure if that's true, but many people believe it is. It is what writers in the 18th century called a conjectural history. It is, that is to say, a kind of philosophical history, really, that is to say, a philosophical reconstruction of history, but not of what actually happened in the past. It's not a history of facts and dates, but it is a history, Rousseau believes, of what had to have happened for, in a way, human beings to evolve to their current condition. Rousseau begins the work by comparing the effects of history on us to the statue of Glaucus, that he says the winds and storms had so disfigured that it scarcely looked like a human being at all. This is what history and time has done to us. It has so affected and transformed human nature that if we want to understand what human nature really is, he argues, it is necessary to reconstruct it through a kind of thought experiment. Rousseau, at the outset, is that okay? Was that for me? Is that for, okay, no. If it was my wife, tell her I'll get the cannolis, not to worry. Rousseau compares the second discourse. Oh, God. Oh, dear. All right. Rousseau compares. Bad to laugh at your own, you know, your own jokes. He compares the second discourse to an experiment like those undertaken by physicists and cosmologists in his own day who speculate about the origins of the universe in the same way that he is speculating about the original condition of human nature. That is to say, there is no empirical or physical evidence to draw on to understand how the world was actually framed. We can only make, he says, intelligent guesses, certain inferences or conjectures based on the evidence that we find around us. And so Rousseau remarks in one of the most arresting passages from his book, and Rousseau is a man known for writing arresting, paradoxical, and ingenious sentences. He writes, "Let us therefore begin by putting aside all the facts. Let us put all the facts aside, for they have no bearing on the case. the investigation that may be undertaken concerning this subject should not be taken for historical truths, he says, but only for hypothetical and conditional reasonings. In other words, what he's saying is that the history that he intends to unfold is an experiment, much like, again, that undertaken by geologists who try to infer the development of plant or animal life from the existence of certain fossil remains or skeletal remains. And yet, at the same time, while Rousseau speaks of his work as tentative, experimental, conjectural, he has only hazarded some guesses, he writes, you cannot help but be struck by the certain tone of confidence with which he presents his findings. In particular, he discusses and rejects quite emphatically the investigations of his predecessors, both ancient and modern. The philosophers, he writes, who have examined the foundations of society have all felt the necessity of returning to the state of nature, but none of them has reached it, Rousseau says. He believes that he alone has finally, as it were, struck gold. Oh man, he exclaims, oh man, whatever country you may be from, whatever your opinions may be, listen, here is your history, as I have thought to read it, not in the books of your fellow men who are liars, but in nature who never lies. That's a remarkable sentence. For the first time, Rousseau says, human nature will be revealed in the history of civil society explained to us. Listen, here is your history as I have read it, not through other books, but through nature, he says, that seems to speak directly to me, or to which I have an insight. So what is the state of nature, a term that we've been looking at in Hobbes and Locke? What is it that Rousseau thinks he has found that eluded his predecessors? In many ways, we have already seen, I've already suggested, Rousseau follows in the footsteps of his great predecessors, particularly Hobbes and Locke, in attempting to understand the original condition by referring to this hypothetical or conjectural state of nature. In many ways, he praises and follows Hobbes and Locke in doing this, but suggests that they never really took the problem of nature seriously enough. What does it mean, Rousseau seems to ask us, to take nature, human nature, the state of nature, what does it mean to take nature seriously? Again, to understand it, to understand human nature, what it originally is to conduct a sort of thought experiment where we peel away, almost like the layers of an onion, everything that we have acquired through the influence of time, of history, of custom, and tradition, in order to discover what is naturally there. So when Hobbes tells us, or when he attributes to natural man certain warlike propensities, Rousseau figures that this cannot be right. War and the passions that give rise to war can only come into being once we are in society. The state of war is really simply the state of society. This cannot be hold for natural man, because the natural conditions had no social relationships of this sort. And you might say his statement was ditto for John Locke. When Locke attributes to us in the state of nature certain qualities of rationality, of industry, of acquisitiveness, these too, Rousseau complains, are only qualities that we can acquire in the light of society. Property entails social relations between persons, relations of justice and injustice, and man in the state of nature is not a social animal. So it is clear for Rousseau that human nature is something infinitely more remote and strange than any of his predecessors had ever imagined. What was the condition of natural man? Rousseau's captivated readers in his time and since by showing that the original condition of human nature was far more like an animal than anything identifiably or recognizably human. Rousseau takes great delight in animalizing human nature, animalizing us. When Aristotle said that man is the rational being because we possess speech or logos, Rousseau says, wrong again. Language is dependent upon society and could only have developed over literally thousands of generations and cannot be a property of natural man. Human nature is a little different from animal nature, and in many ways Rousseau delights in, you can see this in his footnotes in particular, in investigating or stories about orangutans and other species that he believes in many ways are our distant ancestors. You might say a century before Darwin, Rousseau could just have easily entitled his second discourse on the origins of the species. In many ways, the whole science of, you know, evolutionary biology is already in many ways implicit here. And yet for all of our features, our common features with other species, Rousseau specifies two qualities that set us apart. The first is the quality of freedom, or what he calls free agency, although he understands this in a very specific way. Let me read a relevant or crucial passage. In any animal, Rousseau writes, in any animal, I see nothing but an ingenious machine to which nature has given senses in order for it to renew its strength and to protect itself to a certain point from all that tends to disturb it. I am aware of precisely the same thing in the human machine. In other words, he says, animals are just simply little machines that operate by mechanical or physical impulses and needs and desires. And the same is true, he says, in the human machine. With this difference, that nature alone does everything in the operations of an animal, whereas man contributes as a free agent to his own operation.